comes to us from New Zealand. So she was most recently a professor in Auckland. And thanks to the line level and the shader, she was, we were able to recruit her here. And she's a professor of psychology. So post department here is the Department of Psychology. Linda has, I can go on and on about her many accomplishments. But let's start off with some of her research interests. So mainly, she's a health psychologist and looks at, her theoretical framework pretty much guided by self-regulation model of cognition, emotional behavior. And so much of her research really centers on the psychosocial aspects of cancer and cancer communication. And within this, she's also especially interested in looking at emotional regulation processes in terms of how individuals respond to health threats. Now, another line of research looks at it in terms of affect, imagery, and risk communication. And this body of research is also extremely interdisciplinary. She's been collaborating with computer scientists on this. And she also does a lot of work in terms of genetic and risk communication. She's one of the founder members of one of the important international networks looking at research in some of these areas. She's very heavily funded. That's a very impressive record. Also extremely widely published in pretty much all the top journals in health psychology, medical journals, has over, I think the last one was 56 articles, but it might have increased since then. Also very important, edited book, which pretty much gets into some of the issues that she's going to talk about today on self-regulation and health, and also just so many numerous chapters. She's won numerous awards, and in terms of her own approach to work, I'm just now beginning to read up on a lot of her work, but one of the things that comes through so strongly, and I think this is a great role model, is that her work is so theoretical. I mean, so much of it is funded by major health organizations. Applied ramifications are fantastic, but what's really interesting is how strongly theoretical this work is. And just based on my thus far limited interactions with her, another thing which I would also think is would serve as a good role model for so many young scholars is that she truly enjoys her research. So when you think about it in terms of all the different perspectives that someone brings as a top scholar, it's extremely theoretical, it's got some important ramifications, and we're just having so much fun with all this. So that, but.
Thank you very much for a very kind introduction. Can you hear me okay? A little bit louder? Okay. First of all, thank you so much for inviting me to present today. This is very exciting for me, it's an honor for me, and I am looking forward to getting to know your research more and getting to know you more. I'm very happy to be able to present this research on imagery processes in health communications today, particularly because I'm hoping that it might stimulate some conversations and possibly even some collaborations. As Sri noted, I am a social and health psychologist, and when I guess my, as he noted, I'm very theoretically focused. Most of my research is driven by social and health cognition theories, and in terms of having fun in research, I have to say that this imagery research that I'll be presenting today is one of the particularly fun areas for me. And it's interesting to me too because it just seems that social and health psychology have so little to say about imagery processes. And I know that you will know much more about it than I do. But where I'm coming from is that after years of progress in health behavior theories, social cognition theories, the research still remains, to a great extent, focused on conceptual linguistic kinds of stimuli, that is, text stimuli, and the models have evolved looking at these more conceptual linguistic processing systems. And relatively less attention has been given to the concrete imagery processes, and what I see is an opportunity for health and social psychology to kind of catch up and try to integrate more about imagery processing into our health behavior models. So it's also interesting that a lot of our theories have been developing, just as we're seeing in health communications, an opposite trend for more and more images to be a part of these messages. So that as technology has advanced, as graphic capabilities have advanced, we've been better able to use pictures. What we see are far fewer pictures in our health promotion messages and far more pictures. So I think that this is also a clue that we need to catch up in terms of our health behavior theory so that we're able to integrate what we know about concrete imagery processing. And this is particularly exciting when you look at the new horizons we have in communication. So we have the internet, we have electronic medical records, which can take on board images and graphics. We even have virtual reality techniques that are coming up. And we have new advances in graphics technologies, which can depict various aspects of physiological systems very, very vividly. And so I think this is a particularly exciting time to see if we can use theory to help us integrate the imagery processes in it so we can better understand how we select images for use and how we place them and where we place them. Now, my own research has largely been guided by the common sense model, which is a model of self-regulation of behavior, which comes from or has evolved from perceptual motor theories of behavior. So it is therefore particularly amenable to integrating imagery processes into it. And this model focuses to a great extent on the role of illness representations or schema of a health threat. And these schema appear to be structured to process and store specific kinds of information. Information that's relevant to the attributes of identity, symptoms, cause, consequences, timeline, control, and cure. And these mental models evoke or are directly linked with affect, particularly fear and worry, as well as play an integral role in guiding protective actions. And what I want to do is focus particularly on the role of concrete imagery processes in terms of the images that are stored in risk representations and how imagery can play a particularly powerful role in enhancing what we refer to as representational coherence. By that I mean helping people to form very clear, easy to understand, common sense links between the information that's stored in the risk representation and the recommended action so that they have a good understanding as to how it is that a particular behavior such as, say, diet can impact on the progression of a disease such as heart disease. And the research I'll be talking about today just follows a very simple kind of structural format in that we're interested in looking at particular images and messages, and by this I mean pictures, I could mean signs, it could be sounds, it could even be just vivid descriptions that are sufficient to activate mental imagery. These images will create mental imagery within working memory, both of which will activate emotional processes, and together those will activate and shape the development of representations of the health threat, and then both directly and indirectly influence decisions to engage in protective actions. So what I want to do is just very briefly talk a little bit about imagery processes, why they are so powerful, and then touch on three different areas of research that I've been involved with. First, looking at imagery, affect, and health promotion, looking at particularly at smoking cessation research, looking at imagery in healthcare education, focusing particularly on some of the communication programs we're developing for heart disease risk and management, and then finally looking at imagery and risk communications, and we're looking at that particularly within the context of genetic testing for disease risk. So, why are pictures so powerful? Just to briefly remind ourselves about the cognitive neuroscience research as to how powerful images can be in terms of activating concrete experiential processes and influencing our attitudes, our emotions, and our memories, and therefore behaviors. First of all, we know from a lot of research that images are particularly attention-grabbing. We're constantly scanning the environment for new information, and images are particularly powerful in terms of stopping our attention and focusing it, and doing so much more effectively than text-based information or words. Now, you may have noticed in this slide that there's a picture of a dog. The dog's carrying a no dogs allowed sign. And if you're like me and other people, you may have found that as soon as the slide came up, your attention was taken over to the dog. You might have then gone down to the graphics, but then you went back to the dog. And if you're like me, you might find that your attention keeps going back to the dog, even though it becomes really clear it has nothing to do with this talk, because it is just particularly compelling. So that's how attention-grabbing images can be. Last year I was in Europe, I was giving a keynote, and it was the first time I used this talk, this slide. And afterwards, and again, I was using the slide to get across the message that these images can be really captivating, even if they're completely irrelevant to what's going on. And afterwards, I can't tell you how many people came up to me and said, "Oh, Linda, that was a really nice talk. I love that dog picture." You know, so there you go. Even when it's irrelevant, it's still captivating. We know that images are processed particularly rapidly, far more rapidly than text. And we know that they activate the same areas in the brain as do real stimuli. So they are very close to the concrete perceptual reality of seeing the actual object. They're highly linked with affect. The emotional system is particularly sensitive to images and concrete experiential cues. So they are very adept at eliciting emotional responses. And they generate cognitive involvement. They're particularly powerful in terms of focusing our attention, making us process the information, and therefore influencing attitude formation. And of course, we all know how highly accessible to recall they are. So as media experts have known for years and years, a picture can say 1,000 words. But it's also important to appreciate that a picture can negate 1,000 words as well if it is not placed appropriately. So because it can capture our attention, our emotions, our memories so powerfully, we need to have a very clear understanding as to how best to use them in order to convey what we want to convey. So images may motivate protective behavior if they meet at least three conditions. First of all, they may motivate behavior if they are accessible and therefore easily recalled. So in essence, they serve as triggers to action when people find themselves in the appropriate environments when they are supposed to be taking the recommended behavior. They can be effective in promoting behavior if they elicit emotional motivation, typically in the form of worry. And they can be effective if they enhance representational coherence, that is, if they can easily convey how it is that a protective behavior can help to minimize a particular threat.
Can I ask a question, please?
Of course.
So, are we talking about different potential processes here? So, for example, if you say that it increases accessibility, it could be acting over time, so it could be something which is somewhat automatic. But when you say that it's potentially something that elicits worry, it might involve some more conscious or elaborate processing.
By all means, that in essence, we know that many information processing systems are affected and particularly sensitive to images. So yes, in fact, we are looking at automatic processes, control processes, emotional processes, recall, everything. So yeah, and I think that to the extent that we want to be able to track the impact of an image, we do need to track the various stages of persuasion, so to speak, to identify how it is that that image is having an impact in each of the various stages, from attention to acceptance to understanding to motivation to retention and recall.
And this is also sequential. In other words, are you potentially saying that all these could be independent functions, but it could also be that it increases or enhances accessibility, which then leads to increased worry or anxiety, or could they be completely independent?
I think that what we're working with is our highly dynamic processes that typically do work together, but can't have independent influences. So we certainly know that if people are presented with an image that might be subliminally presented, it will certainly activate automatic processes to a greater extent than it might activate control processes. But certainly you're going to have cascade effects through spreading activation and all that stuff. Okay, so one of the questions that we first had was, okay, images are important, but what kinds of images do people automatically tend to store when they are thinking about or having experience with a particular kind of health threat? If people form illness representations that have certain kinds of, you know, tendencies to store kinds of information, what kind of images do they tend to store? And do images have an independent influence on protective behavior, perhaps independent of more controlled conceptual level processes? So one of the lines of research that we're doing is we are asking people about the mental images they store when they think about different kinds of diseases. So what are the images they store in their various illness representations? And in one study, we looked specifically at skin cancer risk, and we invited young adults to participate in a study in which they completed a questionnaire which included an imagery subscale. And this subscale just very simply asked people, before they see anything else in the study, to think about skin cancer, or whatever disease it is, and then just list the first five images that pop into mind. So it's really a top-of-mind awareness kind of measure. We also assess their worry about skin cancer. We know that worry is a strong motivator for protective action. And we ask them about their protective motivations, not only their skin self-exams, but we also ask about their sun protection intentions as well. And first of all, we found that people quite easily could report five images. So it's clear that there are images in people's minds. And perhaps the most common image they reported involved some kind of symptom, like a blemish or a sore. Here's some examples of the items that were listed, you know, crusty, scaly skin, bruising, sores, you know, some pretty disgusting terms, but they all had to do with some kind of symptom. And we found that 44% of the people mentioned at least one of these kinds of symptoms. And what we found was that these images influenced their reported intentions to engage in protective action. I'm just showing you the intentions for skin self-exams. We saw the exact same pattern for sun protection motivations as well. What you see is that people who had both a symptom image and higher worry reported significantly higher intentions to engage in skin self-exams. And in contrast, even though worry is noted as a strong motivator behavior, those people who did not have a skin symptom image showed no increase in intentions with increasing worry. So, in essence, the image was moderating the influence of worry on protection motivation.
When you look at something like that, do you look at gender and how that might have worry might correlate in that sense?
That's a really interesting question. We did not break it down by gender. What would you think would be the...
Well, I think that... I don't know if maybe it's reading I've done that I can't remember right now, but women are generally more prone to worry, or, I mean, I feel like I've read that somewhere, I don't know if...
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I would be curious as to how that might play out in something like this.
That's a very good point. I know that in other studies we do find the gender effect when we just basically see that women in general report higher levels of worry than men. However, when you look at the relationship of worry with something else, there isn't that gender difference. So it isn't that gender moderates it, but you're exactly right that they will tend to have higher levels. So it would be something that would be quite interesting to look at within this context, because as I said, I didn't really see if gender might actually moderate these influences as well. There are other reasons. Oh, I'm sorry.
I was going to ask, independent of that moderation effect, was there any correlation between worry and the symptom imagery? I mean, were higher worries more likely to have that higher symptom imagery anyway?
Yeah, so if you were to take those two lines and come up with the average, you would see that there'd be kind of a slight effect. When you enter the interaction term, of course, the worry main effect completely went away.
Gotcha.
Yeah, but you did see the typical kind of, you know, 0.2 correlation between worry and intentions, but, you know, you definitely see a much stronger correlation when you're looking only at those people.
This is kind of going in a different direction, but were those images actually accurate for, like, say, detecting skin cancers? I mean, is it? I know my dad had one, and it was like we couldn't even see it.
Yeah.
There wasn't to the point of the crusty Uzi or.
And we didn't really look at accuracy versus non-accuracy to see how that mattered, but we definitely saw a wide range of really disgusting conditions that probably weren't related to skin cancer, but that's what they thought might be. But you're absolutely right. Sometimes skin cancer has very minimal, you know, coloration or discoloration. So yeah, accuracy is not playing much of a role here. It's just all what their beliefs are. Okay, so other people around the world are also looking at mental imagery, and I think are coming up with some very exciting information for us. So for example, this group in Scotland used an art toolkit to explore the mental representations that women had of their breast cancer. So these were breast cancer survivors, and they were first asked, you know, if they had an image of their breast cancer in their minds. Most of them did. And then they were invited to use the art toolkit to try to express or illustrate what their mental image looked like. And what they found was, although this was a qualitative study, low end, they still found that there was an interesting tendency for women to either represent their cancer as creature-like, so as a black snake or a jellyfish with tentacles spreading through the body, something that was alive and growing, usually black, and others who talked about it more substance-like. It was inert, foreign matter, kind of a lump that sort of sat there. And it might not be surprising, but the women who had the creature-like images tended to express more distress, more intrusive thoughts about their cancer. So it suggests that perhaps these images are having a chronic influence on these people with cancer. And this is a line of research that I'm starting to explore. I'm interested to see, can we use some kind of intervention to help perhaps replace the mental images they have of the cancer, both, of course, which are inaccurate, but can we help to replace them with more benign images? So, and would that have an impact on their worries about cancer recurrence and intrusive thoughts about cancer? Okay, so what I want to do now is then turn to the issue of using images, and particularly fear-arousing images, within persuasion campaigns. And I'm using the case of anti-smoking campaigns because this, of course, is one of the areas where fear-arousing images have been particularly used historically. We know from the research that fear appeals can be effective, despite lots of controversy back and forth. This one is one that was used in Australia about in 1997. It was known as the mother of all fear campaigns. It was said that people could look at this picture of an artery with a fat coming out of it. They'd see it once and they would always remember it. And more you're seeing that very strong images are being used in anti-smoking campaigns. It's as if, you know, the gloves are off when it comes to trying to get people to stop smoking or not start. Horrific kinds of images. They are going to be switching to graphic warning labels here in the U.S. beginning in 2012. They're using these images in other countries, and not surprisingly, there's already resistance in the U.S., particularly by tobacco industries, against using these graphic warning labels. So there's a real strong need to find evidence in terms of how do they, in fact, influence motivations to smoke. Do they in fact deter motivations? And more importantly, I think, it's not can they in general, but which ones do the best job. So I'm particularly interested in seeing if there's different kinds of images that might be particularly powerful in motivating people to not smoke. I've been working with Brian Williams and Jerry Humphreys in Scotland to explore some data in which people reported their responses to different kinds of images for use on cigarette packs. And this is data from the survey that was conducted in the UK before they introduced their graphic warning labels. And what they did was they did a consumer survey of over 19,000 people in which they showed them 42 different images and asked them simply to select those they thought were effective in making them not want to smoke. Okay, so they recruited non-smokers, smokers, people of all ages, and they simply use the data to select the top 14 that are now being used on cigarette packs in the UK. And they really didn't use the rest of the data, so we leaped upon it and used it to look at a particular question. Sorry, I'll change this quickly, but these are some of the labels that we used, and we're just interested in what attributes are going to be perceived as most effective in discouraging people from smoking. So we did content analyses of these labels, guided by the common sense model, and what we did was we coded them for these representational attributes. So for identity, we identified whether they were focusing on cancer or heart disease or another kind of illness. Symptoms, did they show some kind of diseased body part? You just saw that that was one of the images that was used in some of the labels. Did they show an actor, and if so, what kind? Was it a dead or sick person? Was it a child or baby? Did they focus on cause? You know, give people an understanding of why smoking was dangerous, because it contained chemicals, for example. Did they focus on different kinds of consequences? In terms of the consequences, were they ones that occurred at a young age or an older age? Is it the case that people who are younger might be less responsive to any effects that they perceive as happening to people who are older? And did they focus on control? Was it a message about, you can quit, we can help you, how this is how you can quit smoking? And then we also looked at specific media features, such as the mode, whether they use photographs or graphics, and also the use of metaphors. So for example, using a wrinkly apple as a metaphor for aging skin. And then we used mixed lotion analyses to see how these attributes predicted the odds of, or predicted whether or not the label was selected as being effective. And so I'm just looking at the smokers now, and I've broken it down by the ages. And what you can see is far and away the strongest predictor of a label being selected as effective is if they showed some diseased body part. It was over 6.5 times more likely to be selected if it had a diseased body part than if it did not. And this is controlling for whether it was a sick person or whatever other contents were in their label. Other attributes that promoted the selection of a label as effective included using a child or a baby or a dead or sick person. If it focused on cancer, it was more effective. And heart disease was much less so. And you can see that for infants, it seemed to be slightly effective for those who are younger, but not so much for people who are older. We also found that there were certain attributes that reduced the odds of people being selected as effective. And you can see them here. I think one of the things that's particularly interesting is that for smokers, if it focused on quitting, it was less likely to be selected. You would think that that would be the kind of message that they would like to see the most of, but in fact it reduced the odds of them selecting it. And you can see, you know, skin damage didn't do very well, and nor did addictiveness, even for the younger smokers.
Yeah. When you were asking, did you ask them what they thought would be most effective, correct?
What would be most effective for you?
Yes. Because I'm wondering how much of that really is sort of a third person effect, and that they're thinking that what's going to be effective for the vast majority of people. Where they look and they say, oh, that's gross, so I assume that's going to be effective for other people, but maybe it's not for them. And that might be kind of what's happening a little bit with the smokers and the quitting, is that they don't want to be told to quit.
Yeah.
I think that it might, for other people. Was there any kind of, did you ask, like, do we think this is going to be effective with other people too, more than just, is
yeah.
it effective with me?
Well, this is a UK survey. They did try to say, what do you think in capital letters?
Right.
But you're exactly right that it could be that they still will have thought about other people as well. So I think that would be an interesting question to compare self versus other and see how that might influence some of these patterns. Would you see the same patterns? Would you see slightly different things?
Yeah.
So, yeah. Now, another group that's particularly of interesting concern are young non-smokers, those people who are particularly susceptible to starting to smoke. So here are the mixed lotion analyses, and you can see that diseased body parts are even more powerful for them, over 11.5 times, and that's true for both males and females. Again, child or baby or dead or sick person seems to be motivating them to select the message as perceived effective. Impotence matters a bit more to them. Help with quitting slightly, but when you look at what seemed to reduce the perceived effectiveness, what you see is that things such as infertility, effects at an older age were seen as less effective. But one thing that I think is particularly interesting is, again, the focus on quitting and the focus on addictiveness. Now, this is the crowd that you want to try to get across the message of addictiveness of cigarettes. And we know that people tend to not believe that it's as addictive as everybody says it is. And so you might think that this would be an important health message, but if that message was there, they were less likely to select the message.
If I could ask you a quick question, directly related, but has there been any work that you or anyone else from UNO has done in terms of thinking about how, whether these labels are potentially piquing a sense of curiosity? I mean, I'm just thinking about some of the work done by Lowenstein and Co., where they've shown that, you know, sometimes the reason why we want to try some of these non-momentum acts or, you know, we're interested in some of these things is because it just piques a sense of curiosity.
Uh-huh.
So there's some work looking at the effects of anti-drug PSAs, some of which are very graphic, and then we found that curiosity sort of mediates, you know, behavioral intentions. Saying, oh, I'd like to try some marijuana because I'm curious to see what it would be like. So I'm just wondering whether some of these promote a sense of curiosity more.
That would be very interesting to look at, and particularly among young non-smokers.
Yeah.
I would be very, I mean, you may remember being a teenager and things that were really gross were kind of cool. You know, it could be that these cigarette labels are activating that very same process where, you know, it's that thrill you get, you know, like you would watching a scary movie or, you know, disgusting things on a TV show. It could be that they might be having unintended effects. And I think that's particularly a good example of why we need to test these images and not just at, you know, a simple, do you think it's effective or not, but we need to look at all aspects of the persuasion process to find out, you know, where is it having, you know, the desired effects, but where might it be having the undesired effects? One of the arguments that's often used for these graphic warning labels or against them is they say, well, people will just avoid them, they won't look at them. And there is, in fact, evidence that people are doing that, that by the cigarette packet covers, that, you know, so that way they don't have to see them. But that may not necessarily matter. I've had several people who are smokers tell me, this is in New Zealand where you have graphic warning labels, they tell me that they just can't stand some labels. So they go in and they say, okay, I don't want the diseased lung, I want the pregnant woman or the impotent one, you know. And the thing is that, okay, they're actively avoiding it, but as they're saying it, those images are in their minds, you know, so they can't unstick those images because they're actually using them as they are making their request. So I think it's a very complex process in terms of how they're having their impact.
Yeah. Well, for years we've seen young people saying that the diseased lung or whatever is going to be more effective. But I've heard that the research shows that those aren't the most effective images. So has that research been done, or is that just kind of in the lexicon and not validated?
Yeah, well, I think it's a, as I said, I think it's a relatively complex issue. We are, in fact, doing some research, doing more experimental research, where we're systematically varying diseased lung, the suffering person, and so on. This is work that I'm doing with Mo Brewer and Jessica Cadis. And so hopefully, next semester, we might have some more information about that. I know that I once did a study working with women who were trying to quit smoking, and we were doing a CBT type of group support program with them, and they had a same quit date. Before the quit date, they didn't want to know about diseased lungs or anything. They wanted to be kind of pumped up and cheerleaded, you know, that they can do it, they can quit. After that quit date, though, they wanted to see diseased lungs. They were saying, don't you have a medical school here with some, you know, dead people or lungs in it that we can look at? You know, because at that point, they wanted an avoidance response. You know, they quit and they didn't want to go back to smoking. So I think this approach avoidance kind of motivation systems are going to be playing a role as well. So I mentioned that these labels have been introduced in New Zealand, and I had a master's student who was interested in taking advantage of this and seeing what young people's responses were to these graphic warning labels. So it's one thing to see labels on a computer screen, but what about on the actual pack? So I'm showing you an example of the pack in New Zealand. You can see it has the quit smoking messages, it has Maori as well as English, has the diseased lung on it. And what she did was she just asked them what they thought, and two key things came out. One of them was relevance, and the other was credibility. In terms of relevance, they basically said, oh yeah, we believe this, it's certainly credible, but for my parents, I'm really worried about my parents who are smoking now, because this isn't me, and we all know that people think, oh well, even if I'm smoking, I'm gonna quit in 3 years, so you know, it's irrelevant. So it's relevant for their parents, but not for them. And then we got to this image here, and they just jeered at this image, and they just dismissed it as not credible, that, oh, this is clearly a scare tactic, and in fact, it got to the point where it seemed to undermine the whole credibility of the campaign. They didn't get how smoking causes blindness, and they didn't even get how an eyeball represents blindness. You know, it just made no sense to them.
Well, that's because everybody knows that masturbation causes
blindness. Of course. Yeah, we should have the hands in there.
I'm just curious whether any studies have been done that look at looks like a novelty. I went to New Zealand. I was a smoker. That's actually the first pack I got. I was like, whoa. And then after that, for the rest of the time I was there, I didn't even pay attention to the package, you know, straight in the pocket.
Yeah.
So it works for like a week.
I quit.
You didn't like your cigarettes looking at you, did you? Yeah. Your eyeball. I think that is an important point, and kind of related to that, I presented this at the National Cancer Institute, and there was a contingent from Australia there, and when I showed the slide, they kind of said, well, wait, you know, we came up with that image, and it was the most powerful image in Australia. And they said the reason it was because it was part of a larger media campaign, so that they had a TV commercial where they showed a person as it being wheeled into the operating room, and they showed how smoking constricts the eye vessels, and the last thing you saw was a camera going in on this eye. So for them, they had a whole narrative in which to encode or decode this image. So it could have been that, you know, for you, it was like, weird, you know, eyeball, what does this mean? And, you know, so you can pass it by, but if you had more of a coherent narrative, perhaps it would have stuck in your mind, and you would have had more media signals to, you know, keep that alive. So I think that's another example of how we need to really think about the context of the image and how we can ensure that it is being interpreted appropriately and have the appropriate effect. So, in terms of this kind of affective arousal images, it may protect or motivate protective action. When people have an understanding of the links, you know, between the consequence and the disease and the recommended behavior, and we know that it's very easy that if you don't have a good understanding, that it can activate defenses such as avoidance, you know, looking away from it, blunting, denial, and counter-argumentation, that this is low in credibility, stuff that we've known for many years. Okay, so this sort of leads us to the next area where we're really focusing on this idea of coherence. How can we use images to enhance people's understanding of the relationship between behavior and disease progression? And we're doing this within the context of heart disease risk. And this is an interesting area because we find that people actually may know a lot conceptually about heart disease, but they lack a coherent understanding of the hows and whys. So many people know that you're supposed to eat a low-fat diet, and you're supposed to exercise in order to reduce your risk, but they don't know how those behaviors really impact on the heart. For people with hypertension or heart failure, they really don't understand what's going on with their heart. And they may have gotten the message, you know, quite accurately, that their heart has been enlarged. But that makes completely no sense to them because, you know, the heart is a muscle. You know, muscles, big muscles are good, so having a big heart should be good. So what's the problem? And so there's a lot of misconstrues about what's going on. And of course, you can't see inside your body. You can't see what's going on with your heart. So we wanted to look at the opportunity we had to use some very new technologies on presenting images of physiological processes to see if we can enhance people's understanding. And these are computer-based technologies that can be linked into electronic medical records and web-based health monitoring systems. So they have a potential role of, you know, playing a part in some of these communication systems and programs. with the imagery that we're using comes from the International Vision Project, which is a worldwide effort of computer scientists to mathematically model and graphically represent all aspects of the body, from the genes to tissues to organs to organ systems. And ultimately, their goal is to inform clinical medicine so that they can help doctors make better diagnoses, they can identify the likely consequences of surgeries, and so on. And these are the organ systems that are currently underway in terms of development. The ones at the top are more well developed, so cardiovascular system is at the top, and then as you go down, there's less and less work done. People who are in Auckland, Peter Hunter's group, are the leaders of the Heart Physio Project, and they basically have made a lot of progress in taking patient features and integrating them into a mental representation of the patient's heart that beats and moves, and you can even take your mouse and move it around, so you get a real sense of this, you know, three-dimensional entity. And while they are interested in using it in more clinician settings, we are interested in seeing if we can take this heart image and use it in health education tools, so that we can help people better understand heart disease processes. So we're doing a series of studies, and what we are doing is we are using the common sense model to develop the basis of this education program. It's relatively brief, about 15 minutes long, and we are targeting the illness representation attributes, identity, cause, timeline, consequences, and everything. And we are looking at the unique and combined influences of text-based information about these aspects and imagery-based information. In an initial study, which we did with sedentary adults, and most of them were staff and students, and the reason we wanted to do it with this group was because there were actually a lot of concerns that we just might be scaring the daylights out of these people. And so we want to make sure that it doesn't have unintended effects of causing harm. So we basically started small with a relatively healthy, resilient sample, and we randomly assigned them to one of three of these programs, so one that we just had the text only, or animation only, or it had text plus animation, or to a control condition, which had both tests and imagery relating to screening tests for heart disease. They were brought into the lab, but they were sat down, shown the program, and then we followed them longitudinally to assess their illness representations, their worry, coherence, and intentions and behaviors, specifically low-fat diet and exercise. And we got them at baseline, post-session, 2 weeks, and 4 weeks. Now, let me just show you what the text plus imagery program looked like. This is a screenshot from that program. The person would be seated, and so we got their name. We asked them about their age, their gender, and then we asked them about their exercise status. Of course, we had selected them because they were sedentary, so we could put sedentary into the program. And then they saw this, so it was named, you know, the person's heart, and this was beating at the person's heart rate. So we took the person's heart rate, and so what they saw was the heart beating at their own rate. And they were invited to take the mouse and click on it and turn it around so they could get a good concrete feeling of this thing as the heart. And then they could go to pop-up slides where you could see imagery and get information about plaque buildup, capillary density, enlargement of the heart chambers, and so on. They were told their heart might look like this based on their risk factors, and noted, you know, that there was just mild disease development. Then we showed them what their heart would look like if they ate a low-fat diet and exercised regularly over the next 10 years. And basically, they were seeing, they saw their heart beating much more slowly, they saw no more plaque buildup, greater capillary density, and so on. Then we showed them what their heart might look like if they didn't. And we basically showed that things got worse, got more plaque buildup, less capillary density, enlargement of the chambers. You can see, you know, bad things happening to the heart tissue up there, and then basically that would be increasing. And then at the end of the session, everybody was given detailed information about how to eat a healthy diet, how to exercise, and guided through some very basic implementation intention, you know, goal setting kinds of behaviors. So I won't go through all the results, but what I want to show you is that the animation in particular had an impact you could get heart disease in the near future. What we see is a, while the text somewhat increased timeline risk, the animation did significantly so. And if you look at worry and coherence, you see additive effects, both text and animation, improved, or at least increased worry and improved coherence. And this these effects actually lasted through the entire 4 weeks. So the fact that it was sustained at least for a 4 month period is encouraging.
Linda, can you say again what you mean by coherence?
Sorry, do you have a clear understanding of how your diet or exercise affects your heart? Or is it a mystery to you? There's about four different items, so they kind of go back and forth between clear understanding, good understanding, to it's a mystery to me, I don't have a clear picture in my mind.
So it's not really whether it's accurate or not, it's just whether they think they know something about it.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. So we did not look at accuracy knowledge. We just looked at, does it make sense to you? Yeah.
And so everybody saw both the, this is what will happen if you do everything right for the next 10 years, and this is what will happen if you do everything wrong for the next 10 years. They saw both.
Uh-huh.
Everybody did. Okay.
I was going to ask, have you done any work, or is there any work emerging with people that aren't necessarily living sedentary lifestyles, individuals that might be very active and not realize the risk they have by having terrible diets? I know I grew up in the South, and so fried chicken, you know, fried okra to me was a vegetable and a healthy choice for the last 20-something years. And so while I may not see any external indicators that I might have some severe hypertension or something like that occurring, continuing that lifestyle may lead to an early death and not being sedentary at all. Have you looked at any of like that sort of population?
So far we haven't, but I would absolutely love to, because I think people do have these kinds of common sense, you know, rules that, well, if I exercise, I'll be okay, you know, regardless of the smoking, the diet, everything else. And I think it would be particularly compelling to get people who do seem to have some justification as to why they're not at risk to able to undo those perceptions with something that can, you know, really drive it home to them. Yeah. It's a very good idea.
I also wonder about thinking about heart disease, these kind of colors that have been adopted. Like, I think of the Red Dress Campaign, and which is the American Heart Association for Women in Heart Disease, I think. And I wonder if this kind of research plays into that, like how breast cancer, everything is pink now, and if this kind of research leads them to choose a color that's more relevant?
That's an interesting, you know, I'm really fascinated with colors and the use of colors. And I know that, and you probably know the literature much better than I do, but people are finding that certain colors do have very powerful, unintentional kinds of influences, and you certainly do a lot of associations. I know that Brian Williams over in Scotland is also working with imagery and heart, and he decided to really kind of go inaccurate but impactful by showing a diseased heart in green, because people think of green as sickly and infectious, and whereas then he's using red as healthy, and he argues that we're not trying to get at accuracy here, we're trying to get at understanding. So yeah, I think there's a lot more that we should be thinking about in terms of color and how does that connect to some of the symbols out in the environment that might be also triggering you know, considerations of protection. There's so many interesting things to do. Okay, so how did it impact on protection motivation? I'll just show you a little fat diet. What we found is that it was particularly the animation effects where you saw not only an increase in intentions 2 days later, but 2 weeks later you saw a significant increase. So everybody got the same information, but those who got the animation showed significantly higher self-reports of diet. So I know there's all kinds of problems with self-report, but we didn't have the opportunity to do daily diaries, but at least they thought in their minds that they were eating better. And maybe it was the grits as the vegetable and things, so it may have been completely inaccurate, but at least they were trying to do what they could to eat a low-fat diet.
But also the decline in the text mm-hmm. there yeah. in those 2 weeks, like text
yeah.
only.
Yeah, they just had that effect totally visible. Yeah, so I think that's quite interesting as well.
Yeah.
So the other area where we're looking at is with heart failure, and this is also an interesting heart condition because it's just so confusing to people. When you have heart failure, your symptoms are things like breathlessness, your ankles swell. They don't have anything to do with your heart. When you think about heart failure, people often just freeze at the word failure. I mean, does it mean it stopped? Is it just kind of fallen over? You know, what does that mean? So we find that heart failure patients really have a lot of misconstrues and understandings, and as a consequence, relatively poor adherence to the medications, and this is a very dangerous condition, so non-adherence to medication is particularly a concern. They also have to watch their salt intake, they have to watch their weight, and their diet activities. So we are interested in using a program that incorporates this physiological technology, which we call the Heart Mentor Program. In addition to using images of the heart, we have images of the whole body, and we've made it a daily or weekly monitoring system so that they can encode or update their information on their symptoms, update their information on vital signs and their behaviors, and start to keep more track of how their body is changing and when they change their behavior, when their vital signs change, what that might look like inside the body. And I just have a couple of screenshots to show you that, you know, we have a body. These little yellow dots, you can click on those and get more images and text information. So this is the page that talks about symptoms. So you can click each one of these symptoms and you will see the body shape change. So for fatigue, you see this kind of change. And then you can click on the little yellow things to get more information. And then we have the heart again beating, and we in other places have the heart reacting to medication and such. Now, we've been particularly concerned about using this program with people who are Maori or Pacific Island in ethnicity because of the huge health disparities in New Zealand, particularly with heart failure. The rates are disproportionately high for Maori. And so what we have done is we have developed the mentor program to incorporate Maori words, Maori images, Maori people, so that it will be more friendly to them. But also, because it is so visual, we hope that it will help to get over some of the language barriers and differences in meaning of different words across ethnicities. Another important aspect of this program for Maori is that the body is considered to be sacred, and particularly the heart. I mean, that's just the most sacred part of your body, and it's quite taboo or forbidden to touch the body or use it in inappropriate ways. So for example, women, when they go for a pap smear, will often request to have their cells back so they can basically dispose of them in a ritual or in an inappropriate way because it's precious matter. So you can imagine what, you know, showing them a program where you're touching your heart and turning it around and such, you know, we're a bit worried that, you know, this might be offensive. So we did a qualitative study with some Maori patients and their fauna, because disease is a family affair, and so it's very important to involve the family as well. And we felt that this is the kind of program where they could use it as a family, generate communications and discussions about what's going on. And I was very fortunate to have Eva Moranga as a master's student. Eva is Maori, very active in the Maori community, and so she was the one who did this as her master's thesis. And what she did first was, before showing them the program, she did a qualitative interview where she asked them about their understanding of heart failure. And what really came out was not only a complete misunderstanding of what was going on, but a sense of alienation and even distrust of the doctors. You can see that in some of these I think this last one is particularly suggesting that such a communication program might be helpful. You know, it's just a whole lot of gibberish beyond their understanding. You know, it's not broken down in simpler terms and so on. You're just told you got it. So then she sat them down and she showed them the Heart Mentor program, and they were by and large captivated with it, which we were really pleased to see. And in fact, one thing that seemed to happen was this kind of aha, you know, they'd look at it and then they'd ask to do things again and again, like, oh, do that fatigue symptom again. Do it again. Do it again. It was, I don't know, you remember when you were kids and you learned something new or someone did a new trick, and you said, do it again, do it again, do it again. Well, that was the way they were looking at it, as if they wanted just to process this information by rehearsing it over and over. And you can see from the quotes that there was a very favorable response. I think the last one here, we've learned more, this is a final number, we've learned more about his heart and what is wrong with it and what really is heart failure through this afternoon's interview. Wonderful, wonderful. So it's given us a lot of hope and confidence that we can now use this. And we are just now starting a randomized controlled trial of the Heart Mentor Program with people with heart failure in New Zealand as well as in a clinic in New Jersey. So we're very excited and hopeful that we'll be able to have a positive impact on heart failure patients. Now, I'm not sure of the time. Do we have time for one more? Should we
have time?
Yeah? Okay. All right. So, the final area I just wanted to share with you is looking at how we might be able to use imagery to connote risk information more effectively. And we're looking within the context of genetic testing for disease susceptibility, which I find to be a particularly intriguing area. As you know, there are just more and more genetic tests becoming available on the market. At this point, there's over 1,000 genetic tests that are available. And not only that, but they're being sold over the internet direct to consumer by groups such as 23andMe, Natagenics. And it's very interesting to look at these websites because in terms of health communication, they are doing a very interesting job of it. Basically, if you look at 23andMe, you find that for $400 or so, you can get tests for about 82 different disease risks. And you can see that what they're selling is that this information is valuable because it will help you make good lifestyle choices. You can exercise, weight control, all these things, you can now be a better decision maker. They also note the family importance of this, that you know, basically you can find out what you might be passing along to your children. In terms of what information they actually provide you, it's relatively minimal and it's typically just numeric risk information. So this is from Navigenics. You can see that they just show you your numeric probability of a variety of conditions as they compare to the average person. If you look at 23andMe, they get a bit more graphic in that they use the graphic people to depict how many out of 100 is reflective of your risk and what's the risk for the average person. But there's really not much more information provided. And so there are several concerns. One of them is that people may have a lot of difficulty really understanding how it is that a genetic risk can somehow be controlled by weight or diet or some other kind of behavior. So they may have difficulty grasping these gene-behavior-environment interactions. And there's a worry that it might even lead to what's known as genetic fatalism, that if people find out that they have a genetic risk, particularly if it's a high genetic risk, they might think, oh, well, I'm doomed because it's genetic, it's in my gene, so therefore I just will smoke like a fiend or whatever because it's not going to matter. There's also a worry that people will not be sensitive to the ramifications of testing for family members. We're so used to taking individual blood tests and other kinds of tests that we might not necessarily think about how a genetic test has information for the risk of our family members and process it accordingly. Think about sharing it with their family. And then there's this issue that we've all been aware of in the risk perception research, is that people may be insensitive to risk increments. They may not understand what the difference between a 17% risk and a 70% risk really is. This, in fact, was a question of an initial study we did. We've been doing large internet-based studies to look at risk perceptions in response to genetic testing. This is research that I'm doing with Carrie Sherman in Australia, Teresa Marteau in the UK, Paul Brown over in Global Public Health, and also Bill Klein, who's now at NCI. And we started with an internet study that just looked at the simple question, how sensitive are people to increments in risk within the context of a genetic test? So we did a classic scenario study where we gave people the same scenario about one of four diseases, one of which was colon cancer, and we just systematically varied the percentage of, if you have a mutation, then you have a X percent chance of developing the disease at some time in your life. And we varied those risk increments by 10%, from 20% all the way to 100%, just to see what's the sensitivity function. And what we found was that there was very low sensitivity. In fact, what we found was that statistically, there was, instead of seeing a linear increase in responses of perceived risk, that is, you know, if I had this mutation, what would be my risk for the disease? Instead of seeing it rising linearly with risk increment, we see instead two general clusters. We see kind of a low cost, or sort of a moderate risk cluster, and then a high risk cluster. But there's no difference among those increments. And you can see that that includes increments from 20% all the way to 70%. So that's quite a big difference. So we interpret this as people just kind of come away with a gist, you know? I'm kind of at risk, or I'm really at risk, or I'm probably not at risk. So they're just kind of taking away a general sense. So that led to these research questions that we addressed in this final study that I'll tell you about today. And that is, we wondered if we could use some kind of images, some graphic representations of the risk information to increase people's sensitivity to the numeric information, and or to the risk information. And then we also wanted to get at this issue of gene behavior environment interactions. And we were interested to see if we could give people very simple information that explained the link between a risk and protective action, and have that make sufficient sense that it would change their understanding of gene behavior interactions and ways that would influence their responses. So again, this was a scenario study. This was with four countries. And what we did was we focused on colon cancer risk and a genetic test for a colon cancer, and we used as a protective behavior eating a low-fat diet. Eating a low-fat diet was the recommended behavior to reduce cancer risk. And we did a design where we varied risk increment to low, medium, and high levels, so 20, 50, 80%. We varied whether the risk information we gave them was numeric or was it in the form of graphic, the people array that you just saw with 23andMe. And we looked at whether we gave them this risk action link information. So just to show you what that, the stimuli looked like, this is for the numeric format. And you can see what operationally varied was the 50% chance, 50 out of 100. So we gave both probability and X out of 100 information. Those people who got the graphic format got this very same information, but with this graph as well. For those people who are in the no-risk action link conditions, they were told if you have this genetic mutation, then it says cause changes in the colon's lining that can lead to the formation of polyps. These can develop into cancerous tumors. So if your diet is low in fat, then you will have only small amounts of this toxic acid in your colon. So very simple. And we wanted these messages to be so simple that we could put them on internet informational sources and everything.
But do you think that people, like, do you get confirmation that people understand what a diet low in fat is? Because, I mean, I guess that goes back to your question earlier, because, I mean, then there's, like, good fat and bad fat and this and that, and I imagine that could be confusing.
It very well could be. So that's like, a separate question. It's like, when do they believe that a diet, a low-fat diet will help them? Two, do they know what a low-fat diet is?
Yeah.
So we're just looking at that first step, but that's a very important second step if you're actually putting together informational materials. So first, what we were interested in is basically, did it increase people's reports of understanding? And we saw that there was, in fact, a significant impact of this risk action information, so that if they didn't get it, they were pretty low to middling in terms of how their sense of understanding of this, of how you could protect yourself with a low-fat diet if you had a genetic risk. That you see a much higher coherence with this simple message. Moreover, we see differences in risk so that if you don't get this message, particularly at higher levels, you perceive yourself as being at higher risk if you were to get this genetic mutation, or to have this genetic mutation. lower risk if you get that information. You now understand that you can protect yourself, so therefore, although it's still increasing, it's at lesser levels. And then finally, when we ask them, if you have this genetic mutation, would you try to eat a low-fat diet? And what you see, if you look at the blue line, which is the people who did not get that extra information, you see a pattern that is reflective of genetic fatalism. Those people in the 80%, it's so high, they're probably saying, well, forget it, you know. There's no, I won't try as much as the people in the 20-50% condition because it's probably a fait accompli. However, with the risk action link information, you see a linear increase in anticipated intentions. So certainly this is many steps removed from actual behavior, but at least we're seeing the psychological processes moving in the right direction here. And perhaps I think what's most interesting to us is that we asked them, well, how much would you be willing to pay for this test? You know, we knew these tests were out there, people could buy them. How much would they want to pay for these tests? Now, because we're using different currencies, we standardize them based on their currencies, and what I'm showing you here are the values that have been re-transformed into US dollars, okay? And what we found was that although they had a better understanding, they understood their risk better, if they got this risk action link information, they were less willing to pay for it. They paid less for it. So that, in essence, the monetary value of the test dropped. And this was interesting to us for two reasons. It suggested to us that this kind of information may actually reduce people's sense of mystique about genetic tests. They're no longer some magic formula or magic information that you might not otherwise have. Instead, they have a better idea that, well, you can control your risk by eating a low-fat diet, and maybe you really don't need to know your genetic risk. So it just could be that it's reducing the value of the test because people are seeming to have more control over their true risk. The other aspect that's particularly interesting to us is that because of this effect, this is not information that 23andMe is going to want to put on its website. They're going to keep it at numeric probabilities because, you know, if this holds true, then it really is going to reduce the perceived value of the product. So it sort of further enhances the need for health communication researchers to put this kind of information on other websites, make them available to people so that they can get a better understanding of genetic risk and how you protect yourself. Oh, okay, so what about the graphic people images? Did they seem to have an impact on sensitivity? No, actually, no effects whatsoever on risk perceptions. But what was really interesting was that these little images of people appear to activate social concerns, and I'll show you what I mean. We ask people, you know, do you think you should get tested for the sake of your family? We found that just showing them these little images, which we just selected because Bill Klein could download them from, you know, some bathroom icons, and it was easy to put together in a way. It turned out that these little people may have just actually automatically elicited some social concerns about not only sense of obligation for getting tested, but also, if you did get this test, would you tell your family? These are very subtle effects. They're statistically significant, but they're not, you know, huge in terms of magnitude. But it does raise some interesting questions about how we're selecting images. And these kinds of icons, these kinds of human representations, might have an unexpected impact on people's considerations. After I got this data, I started to pay closer attention to the genetic testing information brochures. Some have happy people on them, family members, and others don't. And so you can imagine that could make some differences. And I think that's a particularly interesting line of research to explore. So just to summarize that even minimal information about the risk action link could affect risk appraisals in ways that might motivate protective behavior. We certainly want to carry this forward to look at actual behavior now, and that these graphic representations of human pictures might have some kinds of effects that have an impact as well. So just to wrap up, this is really some of the research we've been doing to look at how image-based technologies might be used to further understand, further promote understanding of some very complex decision processes, and not only in order to develop more effective communications, but I think this work can feed back to help us better develop our behavior theories and communication theories as well. So I see it as a real dynamic back and forth kind of relationship. So with that, I'd just like to acknowledge my wonderful collaborators in New Zealand and around the world, and thank you so much for your attention.
Motivation that you talked about it in most of your presentation were negative things. Mostly it was fear, it was worry, it was looking at negative symptoms. Have you or anyone else looked at sort of the same image, done some of the same imagery work, but looking at the only thing you looked at that was positive was, as I asked earlier, the heart. Like, if you did everything right for the next 10 years, this is what your heart would look like.
Yeah.
Have you done any, has anyone done any of that sort of positive framing work?
It's a really good question, and my sense is that, and this is just my personal idea, is that it depends on where you're starting from. So if you think you're great and healthy and doing unhealthy things, then maybe you need to activate concern. If you're already, you know, concerned but almost paralyzed, then maybe you need the positive. One study where we used a mental imagery exercise for people who are sedentary, and the mental imagery exercise involved them thinking about going on an exercise and then experiencing all the benefits and rewards. Mm-hmm. And so that was a positive mental imagery, and we found that it had a very significant effect on improving people's exercise appearance, more than just telling them to do the action planning. Think about where you're going to be and how you put on your gear and everything else. So I think it was that reward approach motivation that was being activated that got them to do that positive behavior.
Okay.
But I think there's probably so much more you can do with positive imagery that we really need.
Yeah. It was a fabulous program of research. I really love how you've integrated the cultural aspects as well, because there probably are significant cultural differences in what Sri and I were talking about, even color. So white in China means death, but you would wear white to a funeral in China, but black to a funeral in the United States, that kind of thing.
Huh.
So that there would be, I would think, there would be some significant cultural differences here in what's going to be most appealing or the unconscious response to things.
Also green. Green is considered good in some cultures.
Yes.
And I think there's a faculty member in NC State, he had a whole thing on color. I forget, color concepts. It's basically, he explores how green could have a really positive effect. And like in an Islamic nation, green is in the flag. But in some other countries, green, as you illustrated, may have very different perceptions.
Right. That's fascinating. That's
what you did. Each of those, if you imagine the table, images, you take what images, and you divided it up over, you took your 19,000 people, that data, the Jewish data, and you look at it like the youngest thousand, the next thousand, the next thousand, how many did it, if you went by age, it made it feel slightly different, I mean, in terms of age,
right.
So that the difference is, instead of targeting, like, you know, just look at the sheer. Times of them.
the, you know, points in the trajectory where certain messages are particularly salient. I can certainly see that, say, within like 16 to 24 year olds, there must be a lot going on in terms of change in that area. I think it would also be very interesting to look at people in terms of how long they've been smoking for, you know, at what point, you know, do certain images have an impact, say, early on, but not later.